objective of the project was to use water stored in large capacity to generate and store electrical energy from off-grid residents located in a temperate region. Some of our requirements, the first one is to generate enough power to use a LED map rated at 12 volts, 100 to 1,000 milliamps, 2 hours a day. The system elements cannot contaminate water at all for the use of drinking and household use. Connection must be air and water tight. The system must withstand a temperature range of 32 degrees Fahrenheit. 20 pounds per square inch water pressure must be delivered to the residents for showers and other uses. Turbine head range between 50 and 100 feet. The overall efficiency of the system must be greater than 25%. In the last 1 year without maintenance, and the flow must be maintained at 6.7 gallons per minute. Here's a block diagram of our system. The water will start in the upper mesh, flow through the generator system, which is our 1224 volt DC small voltage fan. It will flow into the lower mesh and eventually to the residence. The electrical output of the generator will go into the intelligent battery charger and eventually charge the battery. A mechanical flow valve system will be used to control when and how much water flows from the upper cache to the lower cache. And this is an overview of our system. Initially, we didn't have the lower cache. We had the generator, or DC small voltage fan, directly in line with the upper cache and the residence. The problem with this is that whenever you use your water for flushing the toilet or washing the dishes, there would be different flow rates and different volumes for everything that you do. And the problem with this is that turbines are designed to not float. So I guess the efficiency of the system will change if you're changing the flow. And so to try and resolve this problem, we implemented this lower cache to make the flow more consistent and more predictable. Now we'll talk about the components of the actual system. Christine will talk about the 24-volt DC small voltage fan.
All right, some of the reasons that we selected the DC small voltage fan is that it was a self-contained unit, and it also combined the generator and the turbine in a single unit. The fan provides the turbine, the DC motor running in reverse acts as a generator. One of the reasons we also had budget costs, that we had to find a cheap device. This way, by using this device, we could actually run multiple tests on it, and if anything happened, we could actually easily buy a new one and run several tests. Also, some of the problems that we found was that it's, first of all, it was designed for air and not water. So the electrical components needed to be waterproof, and also that the blades of the fan, being designed for air and not water, were not positioned properly. So that was the design aspect that we had trouble with. This is basically the test setup that we came up with. As you can see on the left-hand picture, we sealed the fan off as best we could. What you actually can't see is underneath there's a draft tube, which is a 2-inch diameter ball valve, which we would use to control the flow so we could take tests of the system at varying flows to test the efficiency. Also, as you can see, the hose has a circular output, and the fan itself has a rectangular inlet. So we had to cut a small piece of polycarbonate plastic and put it in between to seal it off. We found that this was a problem because the bond holding the polycarbonate, even though epoxy says waterproof, it doesn't mean that it will hold against large pressures of water. We then kind of had some mistakes with the design in the sealant. We ran the test by running the hose up the side of, actually this is Mike's residence, and it gave us a head of 39 feet, 1 inch. It wasn't our required head of 50 feet, but we wanted to actually test the system as a whole and make sure that it worked. We found that the pressure was too great for the seals, and that the system leaked all over the place. Also, the gaps in the fan prevented the water from spinning the fan properly. And our lack of mechanical background was pretty much the leading factor that caused these problems. This is just an example. This is the interior of the DC squirrel cage fan. As you can see, this whole, all this those all these electrical components needed to be sealed properly. And actually, when we did, we sealed them using silicone. And when we did run it underwater, there weren't any problems. It was when we submerged that there was a problem. And we actually found out later on in the project that these gaps between here and down here in the fan are really problematic. In the hydro industry, we were given the example of a turbine that's 169 inches across. They actually, the gaps in between the blades of the fan and the walls of the tube, they have to measure them and make them very, very thin. So as you can see, with such a small device, the ratio of these gaps to the diameter of the fan is huge. So basically what happens is the water runs through those gaps instead of running through the fan, and the opposing forces just keep the fan going. To resolve this, we decided to test the system with compressed air. There was compressed air available in the labs. With using compressed air, we were able to see that the fan was capable of the power output we required, and also that it was able to power the charging unit. Yet again, another note, future implementation requires a focus on improvements in the mechanical aspects. This is one of the results, the graphical results of the compressed air. Some of the things that we can notice here, I mean, the peaks and the valleys are really extreme. When you run the fan in reverse. We required smoothing to make this work better with our charger to give it a more average voltage output. But some of the key things, like right here, you can see that there's a really short time period for the fan to ramp up to full capacity, which means that over the course that we're running the water from the upper cache through the turbine to the lower cache, it'll be running at maximum efficiency for most of that period, which was good knowledge for us. We did the same experiment. This time we actually used to measure the voltage across an RC circuit just to get a clear signal. As you can see, there is a clear voltage output, and the DC motor can be run as a generator. And also, the circuit was a 10 kilo ohm resistor and a 100 microfarad capacitor, and we measured across that. And Victor will talk about the
one of the unique aspects of our charger is that it needs to work with both a limited power supply of several hundred gallons of water and a limited charging time, 1 hour per day. And so we need to worry that our charger, unlike most commercial chargers, won't have that constant power supply which is using the 120 volt AC outlet. Additionally, we need to be concerned with the battery lifespan, and that entails being concerned about overcharge prevention. Otherwise, the battery may rupture and fail. The intelligent battery charger that we built uses a PIC microcontroller to deal with these issues. In addition, it has the capability to detect the overcharge before it happens. It has two status LEDs which use to display information about what it's currently doing. Experimentally, we found that the charging efficiency was 67%, and that given 1 hour of charge, a 12-volt nickel cadmium battery would be able to power a 12-volt LED lamp with a current draw of 0.2 amps, so above our minimum requirement of 0.1 amp. The battery charging algorithm is pretty simple. It starts off with a check to make sure that a battery is present. If the battery is present, it will wait 30 seconds for the battery to stabilize. This is just in case the battery has just recently been discharged and then placed into the circuit. Then it moves into a three-phase charge cycle, in which it starts with a slow charge at 0.2 amps, and it runs at that charge current for 4 minutes. The reason for this is that we found that charging it at its maximum save rate would potentially damage the battery, and so we would want to avoid that. After 4 minutes,